Good morning. Is that a good time of worship or what? Amen. God is good. I just want to say real quick that, you know, how many know that these are kind of fearful times? They can be. And I just want to tell you that, you know, I've had to basically stop watching the news because you guys say I'm way too political. But if you watch the news, it's hard not to be political. Amen. But, you know, I just want to say this, that as the Bible says, in the last days, iniquity will abound and men's hearts will wax cold. How many believe, if you've been around like I have, you've seen that's starting to happen. And I just believe with all my heart, the way to fight that is to get to press in deeper with the Lord. Amen. That if we can be swept away with the world in the fear, or we can know that God is in control. And as we're going to see today, that God's already said it's going to happen. So it's not like God said it was going to be great and then it got bad. He said that this is going to happen. And so we need to rest that if God's got us through this far, he'll get us all the way through. Amen. And we just have to have the peace. And we can't freak out. You know, they say at elections, everyone freaks out. They kind of freeze financially. We need to keep seeking the Lord with all of our heart. The answer is not to shrink back from God. The answer is to press into God. Amen. And so that's what we want to do. And as we see today, you know, I'm talking today that it's Daniel chapter 12, verse 1. And the title is The Great Tribulation. Now, what's great about that is we're not going to be here. Amen. So, you know, and if you want to be here, maybe God will answer your prayer. But I believe the Bible teaches in a pre-trib rapture, that means we are out of here before the tribulation comes. How many believe that? I believe that, right? And so, you know, but I always say to people, if you want to be mid or post and you want to stay through it, God bless you. You know what I mean? But I believe, as we'll see today, that God says we don't have to go through it, that's what he says. Would you like to hear a joke? Yeah, okay. Here it is. Two Christians have lived, they lived a very good life, and they were very healthy lives, and they died, and they went to heaven. And they were walking along and marveling at paradise around them, and one man turns to the other and says, "Wow, I never knew heaven was going to be this good. It was going to be this awesome." And the other guy says, "Yeah, just think, if we hadn't eaten all those bran muffins, we could have been here 10 years earlier." I'm kidding. Yeah. I got one more. You want to hear one more? This one, I like this one better because I'm just weird. But there was this guy, he was driving down the road and he sees a bunch of bikers. And these bikers are kind of around this girl and there's like 50 of them. And he just senses something's not right. And so he sees these bikers around this girl in the parking lot. He pulls in and he grabs a tire iron out of his back. Dog's looking at me like, "What about bikers? It's going to be good, dog." But anyways, he grabs a tire iron out of his car, and he goes right in the middle of the group and says, "Leave that girl alone." And the guy goes, "Yeah, what are you going to do about it?" Well, the guy had a nose ring and had a chain from his nose to his ear, and he just grabs the nose ring and just rips the chain off and hits the guy over the head with the tire iron and says, "Who's next?" And all of a sudden, I messed up the joke already. But anyways, let me preface. Remember that part. Let me go back. This is why I don't tell jokes right here. But anyway, he's standing at the gates of heaven, and Peter is saying, "So why should I let you in?" And he says, "Because I was a good guy." And he says, well, what did you do that was so good?" He goes, "I don't see anything in the books that you did good." And so then he's telling him this story that I just messed up. But anyways, so he's saying, so he grabs a tire iron, and he says, "Who's next?" And I also messed up. Boy, oh boy. Never mind, I'll tell it next week. Forget it. Anyway, so Peter says, he goes, "So why should I let you in?" He tells this story, and then he goes, "I don't see it on the books." And he goes, "When did this happen?" He goes, "A minute ago." Get it, biker? No? I really messed that one up. All right, that's why Kevin's like, "I am the joke teller here." Okay. Anyway. Yes, he won that one. That is definitely, give Kevin a clap. He's the joke man. This is why I write my jokes out, because I will mess it up. But anyways, historians tell us that since 650 BC, that there have been, hear this, 1,656 arms races. That means nations racing to have the best weapons to be able to fight other nations or other empires. Between, and it's usually between two major empires. Out of those 1,600, all but 16 ended in war. Between those two empires, there's usually war between the two big empires. The 16 that didn't end in war out of the 1,600 and whatever, 56, that the only reason they didn't go to war was because the races caused the countries to collapse economically, to fall from world power. Secular military history doesn't give us a lot of hope for peace. And how many know the Bible says that, right? That when the world's saying peace, peace, there is no peace. And how many know the world leader is going to say that, and people try to say it, but we know from the Word of God there is not going to be peace in the last days. And we see that. And so hear this, guys. God says this because why? That your hearts would not be troubled. Because if God said it, then that means he's warning you, and that means he's saying that fear not, for I am with you. And how many know this? God doesn't promise you an easy life. But he promises to be with us. And he promises to give you the peace of his presence and the joy of his salvation. But you have to remember, he said, if you want to live a godly life, you will suffer persecution. And how many know, the way things are going, I can see that. Now, I know you don't want to hear that, and I don't want to hear it, and I don't want to preach that, but guess what? The only good I see out of this, the good I hope to see out of this, is that as things, the screws kind of come tighter from the enemy to this nation, that it hopefully will be the screws that wake us up and say, we need to seek God again. Amen. Amen? And so we can either pull away and freak out, or we can press in. And I pray that we want to be a body that presses in. Amen? That we seek first the kingdom of God. And I always love that verse. You know, everyone knows Jeremiah 29:11, but we need to remember Jeremiah 29:13. That God says through Jeremiah, when you seek me, you will find me when you search for me with all your heart. And God's asking us to search for him. God's saying, and that's what I want us to see, is when hard times come, that's the time to press in. I love that about David. When hard times come, you know, think about this. David's at Ziklag. He's got his 400 mighty men. They've been kicked out of Israel, and they're in the pagan country. And what happens? Guys come in, steal their kids, steal everything. And so David's mighty men are so distraught, they now want to kill David. I mean, that's a bad day when all of a sudden, if you guys said, you know what, Craig, you preach such bad sermons, you've messed up so bad, we're going to kill you. That would be a bad day. So what does David do? He goes, gets a six-pack, and watches TV. No. What does he do? That's what, hey, how did you know? No, but what did he do? He turned to the Lord. It says he encouraged himself in the Lord, and he heard from God. He encouraged himself in the Lord encouraged him, and then he heard from God a strategy to get everything back and more. How many know that's God? Amen. That's what we need to do. That's the kind of people, I don't know about you, I want to be like that, amen? I think we all love David, right? We all love David. We all love David, and we want to be like him, and so we need to have that heart and press in. Biblical prophecy, as well as we'll see here today, says the same thing, that there's going to be some heavy-duty conflicts ahead. These battles will conclude in Israel. The Battle of Armageddon. How many have heard of the Battle of Armageddon? It's going to be a Megiddo. And the way to describe it, I don't know, we don't have the picture. We don't have the picture anymore, do you? You don't have that picture of Armageddon or Megiddo? Oh, get it up. But here it is it's like picture looking off of Mount Lemmon into kind of Tucson Valley with no houses. And that's the Valley of Armageddon. It's huge. And think about how monstrous this battle is going to be, that blood is going to be up to 4 feet, at least 4 feet, as high as the horse's bridle, 4 feet thick of blood. Isn't that amazing? I mean, that's how crazy this is. This battle is going to happen. And I've looked over there. I've looked at Megiddo, and just to imagine that just freaks me out that you're going to see. And it looks so peaceful. It's farm country now. It's all these fields and kind of beautiful. Yeah, there it is right there. Look at that. Can you believe that's going to have, the Bible prophesies it's going to have blood. And that's kind of the tell of Solomon, but that's a valley down below, and it's going to have blood. So that's the Battle of Armageddon. Antichrist will consolidate his power, but he'll find himself very unpopular. How many know that's pretty wild? How many know the devil's pretty popular in our country today? But how many know someday he's going to push his agenda so hard that the world is eventually going to say, I don't like you. We've seen how everyone at first is going to embrace him as a world leader, but now everyone's going, wait a sec, you aren't what you said. How many see that a lot? How many say that with politicians? They promise the world and give us nothing, right? I mean, they go back because why? They're career politicians. They have an agenda. It's not about what is right. It's about I want to stay in office. Because guess what? The only jobs in America that seem to be paying really good are what? Government jobs, okay? How many know your taxes always go up? My house stays the same, but my property taxes go up. You notice that? How does that work? I don't know. Government jobs, so get one. Anyway, but I'm just kidding. But what's going to happen is we saw last week, that or 2 weeks ago, that China, the king of the east, will march with his 200-man army across the Asian landmass. Isn't that amazing? 200 million men. And you know, you say, whoa. You know, when Daniel saw this, he would probably have thought, I must have heard wrong. There's no way. Because back then they believed there was only about 200 million people on the earth. But now, how many know, China in about 1965 said that they could call in about a month a 200 million man army. Now, how many know it's probably bigger now, so they could probably call bigger, but at least a 200 million man army. So they're going to be coming down to Antichrist across the Asian landmass. Down the Valley of Megiddo, the Russians from the north are going to come down. And the king of the south from Egypt, from the south, is going to come up. And the Arab countries will consolidate. All these countries will move north to fight against the Antichrist, who will make his capital in Jerusalem. He'll be boxed in or pinched by all these people coming against him, and he'll just have to sit there and wait until the Battle of Armageddon starts. If you remember, as we saw a couple weeks ago, what happens is everyone's coming against the Antichrist, but then all of a sudden Jesus appears and we ride with him. I mean, that's going to be a cool day, right? That's going to be awesome. Riding on white horses with the Lord, that's pretty neat. And then what happens? Everyone then turns to fight Jesus. Isn't that amazing? Here Jesus wants to come, the Prince of Peace, and yet everyone turns against, they go, hey, why fight each other? Why fight the devil? Let's fight the Lord. That's crazy. Isn't it amazing? You know, I always think it's amazing. You never hear someone say, blank Buddha, you know, or blank Hare Krishna. But you always see people use the Lord's name in vain. Isn't that amazing? That kind of shows you how everyone knows the Lord is the Lord. You know what I mean? And so everyone's going to turn against Jesus, and then he will have that sword that comes out of his mouth and have these fiery eyes. And I mean, think about this. This is my imagination. The Bible says Jesus holds everything together. Think if Jesus just goes, no more. You know, you could just like be like a bug, just splatter. I mean, you could just go. And that's probably why the 4 feet of blood. I don't want to be there. Amen? And we shouldn't want to. So let's pray, ask God to speak to us. Father, thank you so much for this day. Thank you for the sweet time of worship. Man, that was so good, Lord. We just thank you for your presence. And we just pray you would just continue to minister to us. Speak, Lord, through me, Lord. As this is not a message we go, woo, but Lord, let it be a warning. Let this message be what I believe it's meant to be, that we are found worthy, that we are found right with you. So when this does come, we are close to you. So we're not overwhelmed. We're not drowning in the floodwaters of judgment because we are with the Lord. And you said, as we're going to see, you've not predestined us for wrath. You've not called us to be, we're not your bride that you're going to pour out your judgment upon. So God, let us be excited. Let us be drawn to be in Christ, to have our sins covered by the blood so that we do not have to fear the end days, the last days. We don't have to fear what we're going through right now, but we can know that God is with us, and someday you're going to take us out of here. Someday you're going to rapture us. We're going to meet you in the air, and we're going to have a 7-year honeymoon with you and just hang out and have good food. I believe fried chicken will be healthy in heaven, and it's going to be awesome. And so, Lord, we're excited about that. And so, Lord, keep us close. Don't let the craziness of these days, don't let the hardness, don't let the sin abounding harden our hearts and make us pull away, but let our hearts draw close to you, the author of life. We pray this and we believe for this in the mighty name of Jesus. And everyone agreed, said,
amen.
Amen. Amen. Amen. Daniel chapter 12, verse 1, at that time, as seen in chapter 11, this refers to the tribulation period, the time of Antichrist. Now hear this. How many know the tribulation period is how long?
7 years.
And it's two sections. It's kind of the first 3.5 years is the tribulation period. The second 3.5 years is the great tribulation. And here's why. The first 3.5 years is Satan or Antichrist looking good. He's saying, hey, I'm your world leader. I'm going to help you. Everything's good. And he looks. He deceives nations. He deceives Israel. He deceives everyone to think, hey, he's great. But then about 3.5 years into it, he then what? Sets up the abomination of desolation we saw in Daniel. And then he's going to say, worship me. He's going to say, if you don't worship me, there will be literally hell to pay. You will die. You will be persecuted. You will worship me. And you have to then take the mark 666 on your forehead or right hand. And if you don't, you won't be able to buy or sell. How many know it'd be real hard to be in Arizona and not be able to buy or sell? Amen? It'd be pretty tough to do that. I mean, some of you guys say, I could handle it. I'll just be a survivor. I'll have a little bunker at Mount Lemmon. Wow, yeah, right, okay. I mean, I don't know. I've been hunting, and how many times you've hunted and not got anything? How many can raise your hands, right? How many know it's good to eat every day? And someone like me, I would have to kill a deer every hour. I mean, you know what I mean? So it'd be hard. But anyway, that turns into from the tribulation period to the great tribulation period, and we see that that's where we are right now. Middle of verse 1, Michael the archangel, shall stand up, the great prince who stands watch over the sons of your people. Michael, the archangel, is one of two named angels in the Bible. The other named angel is Gabriel, as seen in chapter 10. He's the one that's giving this vision. Gabriel is the messenger. If you remember, he was the one who gave the message to Mary, right? You're going to have a son. And he's the one who gives it. He gave it to Zechariah in the temple. He's the messenger angel. But hear this, I never saw this before. Michael is the only one in the Bible named an archangel. How many of you have heard there's three archangels? I always taught that because I was always taught that in Bible college. But you know, the Bible only says that Michael is the only archangel mentioned. We get that from church history, from Jewish tradition. But it doesn't say in the Bible that Michael, it doesn't say Gabriel's an archangel, it doesn't say Lucifer was an archangel. We just assume that. And how many know it's good to read your Bible? I was like, I've been teaching this for 34 years. It's good to know. I didn't read, I just looked and I went, oh my goodness. Nowhere else. So archangel means basically chief or head. How many know that makes sense? There can't be three or four chiefs. So he's the head angel besides God. So he's the archangel who is always, hear this, linked with Israel. He's always the one protecting Israel, guarding Israel. How many know I would like to have, you know, Michael watching over this church and our families. How many know that? I mean, he's a warrior angel. He's powerful. I've heard stories. It's so cool. Does anyone remember Nikki Cruz? Remember Nikki Cruz? It was Teen Challenge. My friend was a big biker kind of guy, huge, 280 pounds. He was my size, but he had muscles. So picture me with muscles, right? And he was big. And he went there to basically rough up Nikki Cruz. And he went there, and Nikki Cruz basically said, yeah, I used to be a gangbanger. I used to be like you. And he points right to my friend. My friend gets so mad, he has a chain, a big, huge chain wrapped around his neck. This is back in like the 70s. And he takes a chain and slams it on the floor. It was a gym floor, it was a wood floor. So it made a huge sound, wham! And he goes, and he looks, he's going to hit him. And all of a sudden he sees this angel, he says, that's like 14, he says it was like 12 to 14 feet high with his hand on the sword saying, make my day. No, okay, he didn't say that. But he said, I saw that. This is my tough friend who's not a Christian. He said he fell flat on his face. He couldn't get up the whole time. He couldn't get up till everyone was gone. He just laid flat. How many know? I'd like an angel like that. Okay? That is pretty cool. How many know that? That's just, I mean, my goodness, I can't imagine what Michael, the archangel's like. He just looks at you, you know, a little flick with his finger and you're flying across the universe. But anyway, pretty cool. I watch a lot of movies. Anyway, but it seems, though, the forces of hell, as we've been seeing and studying Daniel, are very careful. They're very carefully organized. There's demonic forces that are over specific nations, specific regions. If you remember, we saw, when Daniel prayed in chapter 10, and he said, I would have come to you sooner. As soon as you prayed, you were heard. But the prince of Persia, this demonic spirit that's over Iran, imagine that, over Iran said, he said, that prince or that demonic spirit held me for 21 days. Now, isn't that weird? If you kind of want a story, I mean, this is an allegory, but a good book, I think I've told you about this before, is This Present Darkness. Anyone read that? It's a picture. It's not Bible, but it uses Daniel chapter 10, but it shows you, kind of gives you an idea of the battle, the spiritual battle. And it really, what's good about it is it encourages you to pray, because it sort of shows the angels are a little bit hindered if there's not, they call it prayer cover. And how many know I believe that? You know, you have not because you ask not. I believe that in the last days too, and wherever there's an awakening, there's always an awakening to what? Prayer. There's an awakening to worship. And there's awakening to, this is the hard one, holiness. Being holy, being set apart. Saying, how many want to do those things? Now, as Paul said, the very things I want to do, I don't do, and the things I don't want to do, I do. But hear this, we think, oh, see, that's the way I'm supposed to walk. But hear this, we've got to remember as we studied Romans 100 years ago, he says what? Who can free me from this body of sin? Praise be to our Lord Jesus Christ. How many know the victory is for you and I to walk by the Spirit? You and I don't have to be the old man, the old woman, the old nature. But if you don't, if you do it in your own strength, you will be your old self. But guess what? What does Galatians 5:16 say? Walk by the Spirit so that you will not fulfill the lusts or desires of the flesh. How many like that? We need to learn to say, God, help me to be the new man, the new creation, and walk in the newness through the power of your Holy Spirit. There are also angelic beings over certain regions, and Michael is the archangel over he's the four-star general over Israel. And hear this too to encourage you, because this message is heavy. I got to encourage you. How many know the inference in, I believe it's in Revelation 12, it says that one-third of the stars were kicked out of heaven. And most scholars believe that is saying that one-third, when Satan rebelled, he got one-third of the angels to follow him. How many like that? That means for every demonic angel or demon now, there's two holy angels. How many like that? So you need to remember that. They're like Elijah said, there are more for you than against you. Now we're, right? How many know the world deceives us? There's more against us than for us. How many know there are angels ready to do battle on your behalf? And as we saw a couple weeks ago, I got to go fast or I'll take an hour. You guys don't mind if I take an hour, right? Okay. But every one of us has an angel. It infers that we have an angel, that children, says the angels watch over them. So every one of us as a child have an angel. Why would they leave us an adult? We get in more trouble, seems like, almost as an adult than a child. So we have angels that watch over us, amen? And we should be praying, Lord, I love this verse. Here's a good angel verse for you. Psalms 34:7, the angel of the Lord encamps around those who fear him and he rescues them. How many know that's cool? But guess, here's the key. Those who fear God. You fear God, your angel's going to be guarding you and rescuing you. You don't fear God, don't live for God, have fun on your own. But you fear God, you love God, guess what? The angel's going to deliver you. He's going to protect you and rescue you. I mean, you could use some angel rescuing once in a while, right? I told you when Mariah and I are driving down the road and all of a sudden we're driving and we're going and I almost went through the intersection. All of a sudden I see, just as I'm going, I'm probably like 50 feet from the intersection, a big semi-truck just blows through the light. How many know a gas truck going through a light would not be a good day going full? And it wasn't even skidding. It was just like it didn't realize the light. That would have been a bad day for Mariah because she was this side. But anyway, so God is good. And I think an angel was probably saying, slow up, Craig, and it didn't happen. So anyway, middle of verse 1. And there shall be a time of trouble such as never was since there was a nation of Israel, even to that time. When Michael stands up, there will be trouble. And in Revelation 12, and I encourage you to turn there if you can, hold your place in Daniel 12, and now move, if you could, to Revelation 12, the last book of the Bible, chapter 12. Just go all the way back and then go to chapter 12. We see what happens with Michael. He stands up, and why? We're going to see why it causes such trouble or difficulty. Is everyone there? Tell me when you're there. Revelation 12:7. All right, Revelation 12:7. War broke out in heaven. Michael and his angels fought with the dragon, or Satan. And the dragon and his angels fought, verse 8, but they did not prevail, nor was a place found for them in heaven any longer, verse 9. So the great dragon was cast out, the serpent of old, called the devil and Satan, who deceives the whole world. He was cast to the earth, and his angels were cast out with him. Verse 10, then I heard a loud voice saying in heaven, how now salvation and strength and the kingdom of our God and the power of his Christ have come. For the accuser of the brethren who accused them before our God day and night has been cast down. Verse 11, and they overcame him by the blood of the Lamb, by the word of their testimony, and they did not love their lives to the death. I mean, like that. Do you hear that, guys? I want to say this real quick, a little side note. I was studying this morning. The blood of the Lamb, what? It covers your sin. It says his blood washes us and makes our sin as white as snow. How many like that? So that's how you overcome it. When the devil had placed in your life because of your sin, his blood, the blood of Jesus has covered you. So now Satan doesn't have a hold on you because of the blood of the Lamb. How you love that. Then second, it says, by the word of their testimony. How many know the testimony of the word of God is what lets you know the power of the blood? So we need to have the testimony of God's word and say, it is written. How many know Jesus dealt with Satan? How did he do it? He didn't say, leave me alone. He said, it is written. And we need to know God's promises against the devil's lies. Amen? How many know it would have been great if Eve would have said, no, it is written. Remember what Satan said? He always exaggerates. And he goes, did God say you really can't eat any of the trees? He just said one tree. But he said, any of the trees? And she goes, oh, oh. You know, how many should say, hey, it's written. God told me that I could eat all the trees except one and back off, snake boy. I mean, how many know that would have been the good thing? But she believed the lie. And how many know a lot of times, don't get down on Eve, we believe the lie a lot of times, amen? But we need to say, hey, no, we need to know it is written. We need to know what the word says. We need to know testimony. Because what does the Bible say? My people fall for lack of knowledge. We need to know the truth, right? How many know ignorance is, there's no excuse. If you don't know the law, you don't know the truth, then you will get overwhelmed. We need to know the word of God. And hear this, they did not love their lives to the death. Jesus said, you try to gain your life, lose it. But lose your life for my sake and you'll gain it. Amen? You try to hold on to this life, you try to say it's all about me, you're going to lose your life. But you say, God, your will be done. How many know you're bulletproof? When you're in God's will, when you're saying, God, to live is Christ, to die is gain, like Paul, how many know the Satan cannot touch you till God says it's time to go? And how many know, like Paul, you'll say, I fought the good fight and finished the race. Now lays up for me a crown of righteousness. You'll be glad to go. How many know this? You know, David's going to get on me. But how many are excited and ready to go? I mean, I'm ready to go. You know what I mean? I want, you know, my wife wants grandkids like crack. I mean, she wants grandkids. But how many know? I grandkids are good, but, you know, I've been a youth pastor. I've had enough kids the last 20 lifetimes. I was a youth pastor for 20 years. I don't need any more kids. You know what I mean? I mean, I love my kids. Don't get me wrong. I love my kids, except for Cannon sometimes. But I love most of my kids, right? I'm just kidding you, but we're a lot alike. That's why he reminds me of me. But anyways, but if the Lord said, grandkids, get all your kids happily married or rapture, I'd probably pick rapture. How many could say amen to that? Okay? And so that's it. But anyway, that's free. Revelation 12 here, we see that Daniel 12 is talking about that is in the middle of the tribulation, the great tribulation period now, the seven-year period when Antichrist is on the scene and when we as Christians are in heaven with Jesus. How many excited about that? Honeymoon with Jesus, partying, having a feast. I love, you know heaven's good when you got food in heaven. I mean, and yeah, I bet you, seriously, chicken, tofu will be outlawed in heaven. There'll be no tofu in heaven. It'll be chicken, it'll be all you can eat. I mean, it's going to be good. I'm going to be skinny again. It's going to be a good day in heaven, amen? We're not going to say, how's the carbs? We're not going to care. It's going to be good, everything. But anyway, where was I? I don't know where I am now. But anyways, we're in heaven. Yeah, thank you. There you go. The world is going through a series of judgments. And remember this, it's going to be crazy because this isn't just going to be God's judgment, as it says in Revelation 6, God pouring out his wrath on a Christ-rejecting world, because that's why he's going to do it. But it's also going to be Satan is pouring out. So you got a double whammy. You got God and Satan pouring out wrath. And I don't know about you. I want you to, if you get one thing out of this message, hear this. You and I do not want to be here. We want to be found ready. We want to be ready. We want to be like the five virgins who had their flasks filled with oil. We want to be ready, which means a picture of what? Being filled with the Spirit, being ready, yield to God. How many want to be ready? You know? There's a verse in 1 John 3:3. I'm skipping ahead here, but it says, those who have this hope will keep themselves pure just as he's pure. If you believe the Lord could come back in any second, which I know the Bible teaches that, there's nothing that needs to happen. How many of you are going to live right? Because you don't want to get caught in sin. You don't want to get caught with your pants down, as they say. You don't want to get caught doing anything you shouldn't be doing. Because how many know it's going to be a millisecond like that. You're not going to go, it's not going to go, we're coming, get ready, you know, hello. It's going to, I mean, you know, and I want to be found, I'd like to be preaching. You know, I'd like to be doing something really good instead of just like sleeping or watching TV. You know what I mean? I want to be doing something, right? Amen. We want to be ready. But now you might be saying, you know, but Satan now, the world is going through the tribulation. Satan is cast out of heaven, we saw by Michael. Now you might be saying, well, I thought Satan was in hell. But how many know Satan is not in hell right now? He's in where? Washington. Okay, I'm just kidding. No, I'm just kidding. No. But Satan is not in hell all the time, right? But where is he? It says in Job 1:6 and 1 Peter 5:8, it says, we know that Satan roams the earth, and he has access to heaven. Remember that? He has access to heaven. He goes. Remember what he said? He said, have you considered? God said, this is wild too. It wasn't just Satan. God says, have you considered my servant Job? How many know I go, God, don't do that with me, please. Don't consider. But he says, have you considered my servant? He goes, oh, yeah. I've looked at Job. I've roamed the earth. Yeah. But you've put a hedge around him. And God goes, okay, so what would you like to do? Well, you know, the only reason he praises you, the only reason he worships you, because you bless him with everything. Take this stuff away, he'll curse you. And how many can sadly say, I sometimes go, that's me, right? Sometimes, oh, God, this is what I get for serving you? I know none of you said it, right? It was the first service people. But, you know, have you ever, oh, I think, man, I look at how firm God was with Job. I'm thinking, I would fail that test. How many go, okay, off you go. I mean, you know what I mean? You sure blew it. I mean, you know, Job, he says, his accusation is, Job will curse you, you take his stuff away. Well, then what happens? He takes all his stuff away, takes a lot of his stuff, and what does Job do? Freely God's given, freely the Lord's taken away. Blessed be the name of the Lord. The Lord has given, and he says, and all that, he didn't sin. But then Satan says what? He goes right for the jugular. He goes, hey, you know, it's all right. He can lose his kids, he can lose his cattle, and all his sheep, but you touch his body. You touch his body, he'll curse you to your face. And what happens? He goes, okay. Touch his body. You can't kill him, but touch his body. How many love that? Isn't it amazing that Satan thinks he's going to overrule God one day, and yet God has to always say, do this, don't do this, do this, don't do this. I mean, it's pretty amazing. You think you go, I don't want to do anything. But no, you're going to do it this way. He touches him, and what happens? He passes the test. The only thing Job did that seems like any failure is what? He cursed the day he was born. And isn't it amazing? God said, who are you to curse the day you're born? I mean, I'm thinking, that's pretty good, right? You know, but he's cursing. He's saying, who are you to question me? That should put a little conviction on us. Amen? The things we whine about. How many know Job could look and go, you are such a wimp. I mean, you know, my goodness, are you even saved? I mean, that's how wild it is. But anyway, so that's what the devil does. He goes before the throne of God accusing us. So what does he do there? Well, Revelation 12 and Job 1:11 tells us that he accuses the brother, and that's you and I, day and night, always accusing. But here's the good news. 1 John 2:1 tells us that we have an advocate. We have a defense attorney. We have, you know, Jacobian Myers, a really good, you know, but the best. We have a great defense attorney, and that's Jesus Christ. Satan is the prosecuting attorney. He's the one who brings charges and accusations against us. But as Jesus is our defense attorney who says, I object, Father. They are believers in me, and my blood has cleansed their sin and washed them as white as snow. How many like that? Covered. But hear this, you and I need to make sure, hear this, that our sins are under the blood. I love what one man of God said. The only sin God will not forgive is the one unconfessed. We need to, how many know David prayed a really good prayer that I suggest you all memorize. I don't think I have it written down, but hear this. You can write on your notes. It's not. Psalms 139, verses 23 and 24. Great verse. I pray it. I try to pray at least once a week, if not every day. But it's, what does David say? He says, search me, O God, and know my heart. Try me and know my anxious thoughts. See if there be any wicked way within me, and lead me in the way everlasting. Do you hear that? The two main things he's asking. Lord, where am I not trusting you? How many know right now, how many can humbly admit there's areas where you're not trusting God? Finances, election, with my job, oh, my business. Oh. And you need to say, God is good. I trust you. Forgive me, Father, for doubting your goodness and your faithfulness to me. Forgive me. So anxious thoughts, we all struggle with that in this day and age. Second, wicked ways. I think that's pretty explanatory, right? Drive down the street, wicked ways. And you need to say, Lord, show me those things. And how do we know? Our heart is desperately wicked and deceitful. It says in Jeremiah 17:9 that our hearts go, I'm a good person. Isn't it amazing? If you're not sure where you are spiritually, if you're here today and you go, I'm a good person, you probably need to know Jesus a little more. Because the Bible teaches you're not a good person. That's why you need a Savior, right? It's not like you're there to help God. Hey, God, I'll help you out. Craig needs a Savior, but not me. No, we all need a Savior. But our hearts are desperately wicked. Our hearts lie to us. Our hearts say, oh, I wasn't that bad. Oh, you know, I mean, I only hit her once. I mean, you know, our hearts always justify But guess what? When we say, search me, O God, when we say, show me the truth, how many know that's good to know? The Bible says in 1 Corinthians 11, judge yourself rightly and you will not be judged. How many would rather? I'd rather come clean than get caught. I'd rather say, God, hey, I'm a sinner, have mercy. Remember Jesus? I'm giving you a lot of free stuff here. This might be a long one. Anyway, but here it is. Remember Jesus? The Pharisee says, thank you, Lord, that I'm not like those losers over there, those pagans, that tax collector. Thank you that I fast twice a week. I pray. I love you. I tithe on everything. And then what happens? The tax collector puts his head down, beats his chest, and says, Lord, have mercy on a sinner like me. And Jesus said, who do you believe left justified? Now, I'm not saying we should sin so we can beat our chest, but how many know that humble thing of I'm a sinner and I need a Savior and I need the forgiveness and mercy of God? That's a good thing. How many know it's good for us to kneel down? Amen? It's good. I mean, it's hard for me. It's hard to get up. I need like one of those lifts things, you know? But I mean, how many know it's good to humble yourself before God? I will tell you this. Every time I kneel, I weep because it reminds me of how big God is and how small I am, and how holy he is, and how sinful I am, and it makes me just overwhelmed with his goodness and grace. Amen? So if you can't kneel, then just bow your head maybe. But, you know, it's good to show some reverence once in a while to God, because we're like Protestants. Hey, man, I have liberty in Christ. I can do whatever. Hey, what's up, homie? No. Fear. You know what I mean? When we stand before God, what is John, the beloved? When he saw Jesus glorified, remember John would snuggle with Jesus? When he sees him glorified, he falls flat on his face like a dead man. We might as well get used to that now and start doing that before we have to, it just happens to us. Anyway, but you and I need to make sure that our sins are under the blood. And once they're confessed and under the blood, then guess what? They, as it says in Micah 7:19, it says that they're cast in the sea of forgetfulness. How many like that? Your sins, it's like, I love what one pastor said. He says, you look at that and you say, God, remember that sin I did yesterday? And if you've confessed it, he says, what does he have on that ocean? No fishing. You can't fish it out, right? He's willingly cast in the sea of forgiveness. Micah 7:19. Then what does Psalms 103 verse 12 say? He's cast our sins as far as the east from the west, continually going away. How many like that? To never be found. But guess what the key is? You got to confess it. You got to admit. You can't just go, oh, I'm in Christ, so I don't have to. You need to confess. 1 John 1:9 says, if we confess our sins, he is faithful and just to forgive us our sins and cleanse us from all unrighteousness. But we have to confess. We have to say, God, search me. Amen? Did I lose you there? Sam, I'm talking too much about sin. You guys, okay. You guys aren't sinners, right? You're good. No, I'm good. Anyways, I'm just kidding. And because of that, God dismisses the case for lack of evidence because it's been cast as far as the east and the west. It's been cast in the sea of forgetfulness. But hear this, the devil is a tireless enemy, always accusing us. And I just want to say this real quick. I got to say this because sometimes we take the grace of God for granted. Would you agree that the Church of America takes it for granted? Hear this, Ephesians 4:27, I'll try to make this quick. It says, don't give in to anger, which gives the devil a mighty foothold. Now, Calvaries do not believe. I'm a Calvary, but how many know that we all know in part and prophesy in part? And I have to respectfully disagree with Calvary's view. A lot of Calvaries do not believe in demonic oppression of a believer. Do you understand that? I don't believe a believer can be possessed, right? Because you're sealed with the Spirit, Ephesians 1:13. But how many know you can be demonically oppressed, where there's like a monkey on your back? Because isn't that what Ephesians 4:27 is saying? Don't give in to anger. He's talking to Christians. Ephesian Christians. Don't give in to anger, which gives the devil what? A mighty foothold or place. So hear this, guys. Just because we're in Christ does not mean we cannot give the devil a foothold. There's a lot of Christians giving demonic footholds. Pornography, drinking, drugs, fornication, adultery, homosexuality. How many know that stuff welcomes? Here's what I'm trying to say to you is this. Make sure that when Satan is accusing you, that it doesn't stick. Amen? I love what J. Vernon McGee said. How many know it says an elder should be above reproach? You go, above reproach? That means I have to be perfect. I can't be perfect. I'm Craig. But here's what it means. That basically my life is getting to where when people say things about me, it's been dealt with. It's under the blood. It isn't something that's hidden and just, oh man, they finally found out. That's how many know that accusation of the enemy does work. That's how many know God's a just God. How many know, you know, Satan isn't just going, Craig the poo-poo head, He's saying true things I've done and saying, Craig said he would do this, and now he's not doing it. Craig promised not to. Craig said, you know, he would be, you know, I mean, I don't want to say, what is he saying? No, but he said something bad. Or say, let's say someone else. This man said he'd be faithful to his wife, and he's not faithful to his wife. How many know God doesn't go, hey, that's not a big deal? How many know God has to admit that you're in sin? Right? He's not going to lie for you. But how many know this? Hear this. There's a difference between someone who's an adulterer and someone who's committed adultery. There's a difference between someone who was a homosexual and someone who's a practicing homosexual. There's a difference between someone who's a fornicator or has fornicated. How many know it needs to be under the blood? It needs to be past tense. And then guess what? When the devil accuses, there's no case because it is under, it's in the sea of forgiveness and it's under the blood. Amen? Does that make sense to you? Because I don't want to just think, hey, you know, we're all good. Because hear this, I'll end with this. Isaiah 6:10 says we are robed or in his righteousness. How many like that? When you accepted Jesus, he put on his robes of righteousness. He declared you as justified, imputed his righteousness, justified, just as if you never sinned. So we go, yeah. But hear this. We always, how many know, as Westerners, we like to say, that's it, right there. How many know God is paradoxical? You know what that means? That A can seem right at times. Here's a paradoxical. Jesus, it says in Isaiah 9:6, is the Prince of Peace. So we go, oh, Jesus is peace. But then what did Jesus say in Matthew 10? I've not come to bring peace, but a sword. And what do we do as Western mind? Hey, contradiction. Hebrew mindset says, no, God can be the Prince of Peace at times, and he can also bring a sword at times. Do you get it? So hear this. He's clothed us with his righteousness. So he's imputed righteousness. That means he's given us his righteousness. But hear this. This is the part we forget. Romans 13, verse 14. He says what? Now that you're Christians, most of us here have been Christians a while, put on Christ or clothe yourself with the righteousness of Christ. How many know now it's time for us and the church, especially in the last days, to what? Actualize holiness. Amen? It's time to get rid of the bumper stickers to say, Christians aren't perfect, just forgiven. So if I do this to you while we're driving, hey, no big deal. How many know we need to be holy? Because the Bible says without holiness, no one shall see the Lord. Now I want to ask you, how do you go to heaven if you don't see the Lord? So we need to now, you see what I mean? He's imputed righteousness to us, but now he says, walk in righteousness. Does that make sense to you guys, the balance of that? So we tend to just go, oh, it's been imputed. I don't have to confess. I don't have to be honest. I don't have to, I can do whatever I want because I'm under the grace of God. No. What did Jesus say? If you love me, you will what? Obey my commands. Jesus said, why do you call me Lord, Lord, but do not do what I say? How many of you could say that to this church today? You say, hear this, I love what, how many have heard of Henry Blackaby? Old guy, I met him, cutest guy you ever seen. And he was like 87, cute little guy, just sitting in the lobby by himself, and I just attacked him. And he says, you know, people say to me all the time, I just have such a hard time obeying God. I just have such a hard time with being disciplined, obeying God. And he goes, it's not an obedience issue. It's a love issue. Because Jesus said, if you love me, you obey my commands. I know we need to, the word God gave me. If we will focus on loving God, then we will be obedient to God. Because when you love God, you don't want to do, you have the fear of God, and you don't want to do anything to hurt his heart. Amen? Amen? Yeah, give the Lord a clap. There's coming a time, however, when he, hear this, will be disbarred and thrown out of God's courtroom, and that'll be halfway through the tribulation about. Michael will cast him out, and no longer will he have access to heaven. Now hear this, some of you might be Bible scholars, know this. What about Luke 10, 18 and 19? It says Satan was cast out of heaven like lightning. That meant he was cast out from living in heaven, but how many know he can still approach heaven right now, the courtroom of heaven. He can still make accusations against us. But even what will happen eventually, he'll just even be cast out of the courtroom and be not able to accuse us anymore. How many long for that day? Long, good day. But Revelation 12:12 says this in response to this. Therefore rejoice, O heavens, and you who dwell in them, because Satan can't come anymore. Woe to the inhabitants, though, of the earth, those who are left behind the tribulation, and the sea. And for the devil has come down to you having great wrath because he knows that his time is short. Satan will know it's about 3 years, 3.5 years. I got to, you know, start rocking because it's almost over. Verse 13, now when the dragon saw that he had been cast to the earth, he persecuted the woman and gave birth to the male child. The woman here, as some of you know, have studied Revelation with us, is what? Israel, right? And then the male child is who? Jesus. Because the Israelites were the ones who brought us Christ, and so that's why there's such a hatred of the devil towards Israel, because they were the people that God used to bring Christ. Revelation 12:17 says this, and the dragon was enraged with the woman, Israel, and he went to make war with the rest of her offspring, we'll find out that, who keep the commandments of God and have testimony of Jesus Christ. When Michael, the archangel, kicks Satan out of heaven, God bless you, Satan will come to the earth and he'll take his frustration out on Israel. And hear this too, he'll take his frustration out of the tribulation saints, those who get saved in the tribulation. How many know? I don't want to get saved in the tribulation, amen? I don't want any of you to get saved. To go, you know, I was playing games here, but once I get remember what I showed you a couple weeks ago in 2 Thessalonians, that most of the people who are playing games in church will be handed over, God says, to a strong delusion. They will not have a chance. The people that are going to get saved, and this is for you, remember you asked me, the people get saved is the Israelites, the Jews that are waiting for the Messiah. Those are the people that are going to get saved. And the people who are kind of outside of church, they'll realize, oh my goodness, my aunt or my uncle or whoever talked to me about this, wow, this is real, you know. So that's what will happen. So we need to do that, make sure we're right with God. Satan will come to the earth and, as I said, take out his frustrations. That's why Jesus said this in Matthew 24:22. He says, unless those days, the days of tribulation, were shortened, all flesh will be destroyed. Everyone would be destroyed because there's such wrath being poured out that no one will be able to survive. It literally is going to be hell on earth, the closest it'll ever be. End of verse 1. How many of us, we did good today, went through a whole verse. Amazing. All right. And at the time your people shall be delivered, everyone who is found written in the book. A remnant of Jews will be miraculously and beautifully delivered and brought into the wilderness. A lot of theologians believe they'll be brought into the rock city of Petra, found in Jordan. How many know that? How many know that city? It's this beautiful city that has a little narrow way into it, and there's these beautiful rock buildings. They say, Smithsonian Institute said it's the 27th wonder. It's like the seventh wonder of the world, and that you should go to it. It's like they gave a bucket list of 28 things to go to, and Petra is one of them. Has anyone been to Petra? I've never been to Petra, but yeah, okay. But it's in Jordan, so I don't know if that's scary, but you know, it's beautiful. And that's where, and it's so cool that the people believe that they've put... they've put like tracts and Bibles there, so when the Jews go there to hide, they'll be able to read the Bible and know the truth. So cool. When we hear about hell on earth and all the woes that are going to happen to the earth because Satan has been cast down, he's filled with great fury towards the inhabitants, the tribulation saints. I don't know about you, but I don't want to be here when that happens. Amen? Amen? I don't want to be here. So if you're here, if you're like me and you don't want to be around for that, then hear this, guys. You need to be in Christ. You need to make sure that you are not just saved. How many know this? I was talking with someone the other day. A lot of people have made Jesus just Savior. But how many know Jesus is supposed to be Savior and Lord? Savior is kind of the start, but how many know the key of life, the walk now is Lordship? That he has, you know, as John the Baptist said, I must decrease that Christ might. It's a daily surrendering. And I just want to tell you that I believe the way I knew I was saved, you know, it says in Romans that his spirit bore witness with our spirit that we're children of God. The way I knew, I received Jesus as Savior about a year before I believed I was really saved. Because I was just an American. I said, yeah, I want salvation. Why not? Sure, yeah, whatever. A free box of Tide. Yeah, I'll take it. But when I knew I was saved is when I made Jesus Lord. Can anyone else agree with that? When I finally said, you know what, God? You don't just, I'm just not going to use you for salvation. You are worthy of my life. And once I gave that, I knew. I just knew. How do you know? I just knew. And some of you here today, I believe you received Christ as Savior, but you're not sure you're saved. And I'm not going to ask you to raise your hands because you would just lie and not do it. But some of you have that fear. Some of you go, I'm not sure if I was to die today. I hope. How many know you're not supposed to hope? And the hope in the Bible is not hope like I hope I win the lottery. Hope is It's a expectation of the coming good. It's knowing that it's going to happen. How many know you should leave this place having hope, I'm saved, but it should be a knowing I'm saved. Amen? And so I really believe that some of you here today need to make Jesus Lord. And then the second thing is we need to have our sins covered by the blood. We need to move from just being positionally made righteous to now saying, God, I want to start like David praying, search me, oh God. Show me things that I hurt you. Because how many know the Bible says without faith, you can't please God. It says in, you know, Hebrews 11:6. So think of how many times we hurt God by not having faith in him. So we need to confess that. And we also need to what? We need to put those sins, the wicked ways, under the blood. John 1:12 says this, but as many as receive him, Jesus, to them he gave the right to become children of God. We need to make sure that we have received him. How many know he's moving towards you today if you're not sure, but you need to then open the door. I always love that picture, remember, of Jesus knocking on the door. There's no handle out here. Jesus can't just come in. You have to what? Open the door of your heart. You have to surrender to him. You have to choose to marry him as we're the bride and he's the groom. As I said, 1 John 3:3 says what? Everyone who has this hope of the Lord's return is going to be holy. Everyone who has this hope will be what? Will have this, they'll keep themselves pure. And I believe that the proof that you really and I are saved is that we're going to take seriously these last days of really being yielded to God and his holiness. Amen. And I don't know if you notice, there's no temptation out there, is there? No, right? But you're going to say no because you want to be ready, right? You think about if you knew the Lord's coming back tonight at 12 midnight. You would live good today. But guess what? He could truly come back tonight at midnight. So always live ready. The second scripture is Hebrews 10:19, or third scripture, I should say. And it says, so dear brothers and sisters, we can boldly enter heaven's most holy place because of the blood of Jesus. Now think about that. This is the place where if the priest had to have a rope tied around his leg, if he wasn't right, he could be killed and have to be dragged out. They'd have little bells on him so they could hear him chingling, ching, and they couldn't just run in and get his carcass. They had to pull it out. How many know we get to approach the Holy of Holies with boldness? How many like that? But guess what? Let's make sure we approach it with holiness because we've put all of our sins that we're aware of under the blood. That's why I love the Pentecost said, put it under the blood. Is it under the blood? How many know we need to make sure, not just under the blood positionally, but make sure we're confessing, Lord, I don't want the devil to have this thing on me, and I don't want to walk in guilt. How many know the other promise it says in Hebrews that his blood cleanses us from an evil, guilty conscience? Some of you are humble, not because you're humble before God. You're humble by shame, and God doesn't want you to be ashamed. Amen? He wants to free you from an evil, guilty conscience. Oh, you've done stuff to be ashamed of, but the blood of Jesus can wash it and make you approach him with boldness, not in your righteousness, but the righteousness of Christ. Amen? Good stuff. Last scripture, 1 Thessalonians 5:9. And this is to give you hope. You know, I beat you up pretty hard today, right? But here's some hope. For God did not appoint us to wrath, but to obtain salvation through our Lord Jesus Christ. God didn't save you to beat you up in the tribulation. Amen? He's not going to save you then to pour out his judgment and wrath on you. That's why he raptures the church. I love what one commentary said. He said the picture of rapture in the Old Testament is the picture of Noah's ark. He said, well, Enoch, Noah, and the children of Israel are people. Enoch, the church. Remember Enoch? He walked with God and was what? No more. He was raptured. That's us. Then what happened? Who's the children of Israel, the tribulation saints? They're Noah in his boat. They made it through the tribulation. Get it? And then what happened? Who's the people who die? The people who didn't know God. Who what? They die in the flood of this wrath. I want to be Enoch. Amen? I pray that all of you hear this. All of you, I want you to be motivated to tell your friends and family members. Because how many know, there's no pressure, right, to be PC here, right? There's no people to keep your little Jesus to yourself. But how many know people are dying, and you've got to be bold enough, not obnoxious, but bold enough to say, I care more about their soul than I care about my comfort and ease in life. Amen? And we have to start telling people. And I pray that if you get anything from this message, you get that urgency to live right, to put your sins in the blood, and to tell people that, hey, Jesus is coming back. Do you remember? That was revival, the Jesus movement. That's what this church was started on. Calvary was started on a bunch of hippies going, Jesus is coming back! Maranatha! Woo! Right? Now we're like, I think he's coming back. I don't know. Whatever. You know, I'm right? That doesn't really motivate people. You know, he's been, Chuck was saying that 50 years ago. But you know what's neat about that? 1 Peter 3:9 says that that's what people are going to say, right? In the last days, they're going to say, he's been saying this forever. That's when he's going to come. So guess what? If you're one of those people that goes, get ready, he's coming, right? Because you're like, but I'd like to be a crazy hippie again and say, without the hair, I have no hair, but I'd like to be the crazy hippie that says, Jesus is coming back, let's live right, let's tell people about the love of God, amen? Amen. Amen. I've already gone long, I might as well go for it. I want to give some people, would you turn the lights off and worship team come up? But I really feel called by God that some of you here today, I believe, need to give your life to the Lordship of Christ. And I don't mean to make two salvations. That's not what I want you to hear. But I want you to hear that I want it to go from just Savior to Lord. Amen? And then I want you to hear that some of you need to recommit your life. Some of you've made Jesus Lord, but you've gotten entangled in sin. And you're in guilt and you're in shame. And God's saying, hey, put it under the blood. Let's deal with this thing once and for all so that you can walk free. Amen? So when the devil, you know, I always love it when it says the devil accuses you, then just send Jesus to the door to answer, right? Just say the blood of Jesus. Remember the blood of Jesus. And that's what you need to do. There is no condemnation for those who what? Are in Christ. And so the way you're in Christ is that not just positionally, but you're in Christ because why? You can say to the devil, I have dealt with that sin. I've confessed it. I've renounced it, and so you have no hold. It's been cast in the sea of forgiveness. Amen? Will you bow your heads and close your eyes out of respect for the Lord? But I believe, as I said, there's two groups here. There's those that need to make Jesus Lord, not just Savior, but Savior and Lord. And there's those of you today that need to recommit your life to say, you know what, I've been the prodigal son. I've been the prodigal daughter. I've been playing games with God. And it's time today, these are the last days, and it's time to get serious. And if that is you today, I just want to pray this prayer. And I would like to do this, and I always do this, and some of you don't like me for it, but I don't care. But would you pray this prayer out loud so no one feels left out? And if you say, but Craig, I'm really right with God. I've already saved. I've made Jesus Lord. Then just pray it till, you know, how many know it's not gonna, God's not going to be bummed? But just pray it so nobody feels left out. Because Romans 10:9 says, if we confess with our mouth, confess our mouth and believe in our heart that God raised him from the dead, we will be saved. And I want us to learn how to pray so we can lead our friends and family members and moms and dads to Christ. We can lead our sons and daughters. And so just, if you're already right with God, then just pray this to learn how to pray. But I'd like you right now just to repeat this prayer. I want to pray for both groups. Repeat after me if you would. Lord Jesus, I confess to you, and I'm a sinner. Have mercy on me. I choose to make you Lord today. And I recommit my life to you today. I'm tired of playing games. I want to be holy as you are holy. Thank you for your blood that washes me as white as snow. Fill me with your Holy Spirit and empower me to live for you all the days of my life. For it's in Jesus' name I ask. Amen. 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 If you prayed that prayer, you can raise your heads now. If you prayed that prayer to make Jesus Lord or to recommit your life, then would you tell someone, tell me, tell somebody. I think I've gone long here, so I don't want to go over. But hear this. Make sure you tell someone. Make sure you, you know, we live in a day and age where we're the most connected society, but the most disconnected society, amen? But make sure you tell a human. Don't put on Facebook. Tell someone, hey, you know what? I've been playing, you don't have to get into details, but I've been playing games with God, and I don't really want to walk with him. Would you hold me accountable? Would you pray for me? But make sure you tell someone, because, guys, I really want us to be the church Jesus wants us to be, amen? He says he's coming back for a bride without spot or wrinkle. That spot means outward sin. How many know there's a lot of outward sin? I want that to start being dealt with in a church. And he says that wrinkle and that sin within, like hidden sin, pornography, hidden thing. How many know God sees it? And that's the thing. How many know that? The Bible says that the eyes of the Lord search, that everything is laid bare before the eyes of the Lord whom we must give an account. How many know this? You're not fooling anyone except yourself and maybe others, but God sees it. And that should be the thing that hurts us. Amen? We should say, God, I don't want to hurt you anymore. I love you. And I believe if we'll have that heart, God's going to start pouring out his spirit on this church like we've never seen before, and others like it. But hear this, God needs the three things I say. I've studied revival a lot, and there's three, every revival is different, but there's three common things. If you studied, you know, right? You know, Mike. There's three things. Prayer, holiness, and back to worship, and maybe you could throw a fourth one, a love for the word again. Those are the things we need to have. How many want to be that church? Amen? Amen? Three of you. Good. No, I'm just kidding. But anyway, bless you guys. Let's stand and worship the Lord and tell him how much we love.